Good afternoon. Magana hapon po, señor lahat, galing sa Pilipinas. Buongiorno a chi è collegato dall'Italia. Benvenuti, welcome to today's Politech Story by the Politecnico di Milano, the Polytechnic University of Milan, that embodies the excellence in of the Italian and European higher education system in the fields of architecture, design, and engineering. So my name is Alessandro Milani, and I'm managing the Philippine Italian Association, a cultural organization that since 1962 has been weaving ties between Italy and the Philippines, working on different fields like language. We teach Italian language and Filipino as well. We are the pioneer in teaching Italian language in the Philippines and still the leading language center in the country. And we are now also an exam center for the certification of the Italian language proficiency competences with the Università per Stranieri di Siena. In social, we have recently opened a patronato with the ACLI here in Manila, and the mission of this patronato is to extend the assistance to citizens, students, workers, etc., in their mobility between Italy and the Philippines. And we also assist in the citizen to deal with the Italian administration in claiming the rights and the benefits that they earn. Cultural and educational activities as well. We try to organize an initiative in a collaborative way with our institutional and non-institutional partners. The PIA, for instance, is a founding member of UNIC Philippines, the cluster of the European cultural institutes around the world. And it's also part of the cultural and education group of the EU delegation in the Philippines, with which we work on different projects, among which there's the European Higher Education Fair. And I mentioned this because it's thanks to this fair, the European Higher Education Fair, that we got in contact with the Politecnico di Milano, and it started a very fruitful collaboration that is bringing us together today for this third episode of the Politech Stories. This is a series of encounters on Polytechnic culture that the Politecnico di Milano develops with the Italian cultural institutes around the world. And we are very happy that we were able to bring it to the Philippines as well. We started last December, and we are now in May, and we are at the third episode of this series. You know, May in the Philippines is a Heritage Month. So we wanted to, we chose a topic that in line with the theme of the month. A very timely topic, actually, if we read the newspapers and we observe what is happening around us. I'm an outsider. I am just an observer of what's happening in the country, but I can mention the restoration and reopening of the Metropolitan Theater in Manila, the application of Intramuros to the list of the UNESCO World Heritage Sites, but also the interesting practice of moving ancestral houses from the cities where they were built to other places, safer places, sometimes private places outside the cities. So with this today, with this webinar, we want entitled Architectural Heritage as Expression of a Local Community's Identity. We will try to deepen the topic. The webinar will be organized in two parts: the lecture and the Q&A part. So feel free to write your questions as they come during the lecture in the chat box, and then we will collate them and read them during the question and answer. Now let me introduce the speaker. She's an associate professor in architectural restoration at the Politecnico di Milano. And she has a PhD in restoration and history of architecture. Her fields of research focuses on many fields. history and theory of restoration, history and construction phases of the buildings, analysis of traditional and modern construction systems, analysis of mechanical behavior of historical structures, studies on the conservation of historical centers, research on enhancement of archaeological areas and modern architecture in Italy, Georgia, and Bulgaria. Please welcome Professor Nora Lombardini. Buongiorno, professoressa. Benvenuta nelle Filippine, virtualmente.
Thank you so much, really. Thank you so much, Mr. Milani, for this introduction. Of course, you listed a lot of fields, but also because I am not so young, so only for this reason. So it is a great opportunity for me to be here, especially with the guests coming in the Philippines. And I would like also to thank you very much, the supporters from Politecnico di Milano. So it is a great opportunity also because now we will start to speak about the several questions connected with restoration and conservation, especially of architectural heritage, even if you know that nowadays we can speak about tangible architecture, of course, is tangible, and intangible heritage. That means that we have to combine the two, subjects, really, tangible and intangible, in order to ensure the transfer to the future generation of our past. What I would like also to underline is the importance of the conservation of our past and of the meaning of it. But which kind of policy we can approach and which kind of project we can adopt in order to ensure the future to of our past. So, to our past. So, I start with sharing my presentation. So, architectural heritage is expression of local community's identity. So, you can read here. So, architectural heritage, that is clear more or less what is it, or it could be, or it would be clear. Local communities and identity. So, we will try to underline a little these three locutions, concepts useful to understand what is restoration and the conservation of them. So, but what is restoration nowadays? So we know that we started to speak about restoration in the middle, in the scientific, from the scientific point of view, in the middle of the 19th century. Of course, restoration means that we have to keep in care our ancient structures in order, as I said before, to transfer them to the future generation. But nowadays, it is not only the only action, the only aim of what we have to do. Because the restoration and conservation of cultural heritage is really rooted in the different cultures. So when I speak about this process, first of all, I am referring to Italy, but when I am speaking about this also in other countries, I have first of all to understand the cultural background of the country in order to understand, first of all, what is cultural heritage in another country and in which way they are able to define cultural heritage according to which kind of parameters and at last in which way they can conserve, which according to which kind of methodology they can conserve and transfer to the future generation the goods. I would like to tell you that when in Italy we speak about the project of conservation, it is really a project, as an architectural project. As an architectural project, we can every time arrange and design the restoration. The subject of restorations, I mean in Italy, usually are, of course, what usually we can define as monuments. So we can speak about buildings, we can speak about historical centers, we can speak about archaeology, also industrial archaeology and so on. But this way to work on the built environment, on monuments, sorry, can be used also for the normal built environment. It can be an approach useful to conserve the elements. Why this? So what I would like to underline is that restoration can be a process, the project of conservation restoration, and of course we will speak and we will have the opportunity to understand a bit more what I am speaking now. But it is a process that can be more sustainable than something else. Why this? Because it is sustainable because we can consider that the knowledge and the respect of the existing built environment, the existing buildings, is really convenient, especially because I don't speak about demolition, but I am speaking about conservation. So the procedure that we can use needs of a methodological approach, of a technical solution, but restoration can have also an ideological dimension and the needs of a theoretical background. When we speak about restoration and conservation, we speak about also the improvement of the use of the existing buildings. We can speak about assessment and enhancement, perhaps of an archaeological place, and we can speak about musealization. Usually in Italy, we speak about valorization. Valorization means that we have also to ensure the accessibility of everyone to the good, to the architectural heritage. Restoration is connected with identity. What is the expression, what is a symbol of heritage in each country? Sometimes, as happened to me, that I was abroad and I found very interesting something that was not so interesting for the indigenous people. Why this? Because if I evaluate the heritage from the historical point of view, we have also different perception of what is history for the different populations. So it is important for this reason, to understand what is the identity of the country and to discuss with the other country, with the other about the definition of this identity. I can tell you starting from this point of view, that the care of cultural heritage is also dialogue. And it is based on a very important and understandable intercultural dialogue. Conservation of cultural heritage is based on this. How you can see here, but we will have the opportunity to see something else after. This is the approach that we can have in restoration and conservation in Italy. It is only an example, perhaps we can also come back to this, but in this moment I am speaking not about demolition or replacement, so restoration as replacement, but conservation means that I have exactly to conserve what I am finding now, and I have to conceive the additions in a very new way, with a very new shape. So additions is an expression of the modern architecture. So when we speak about conservation in Italy, especially when we speak about, but not only in Italy, when we speak about, I was in Germany, and more or less the approach is the same. When I have to add something in order to improve the use of a building that is more or less destroyed and so on, we can add new elements and new solutions, but starting for a deeply analysis survey of the existing parts that are the historical part of the building, also with an artistic value. What we have to respect is the authenticity of the good. And authenticity means, so I would like to ask you, what is authenticity? Authenticity of a building is exactly what I can touch, not the original shape, not what was the building in the past, but I have to respect all the historical phases of the place, of the building, of an archaeological remains. So I have to respect everything because the building is the witness of its history. The place is the witness of its history. And I cannot cancel this history. Can restoration be selective? Selective because it is possible to choose what I want to conserve or not, for instance, or selective because it is possible to adopt methodologies and techniques of restoration that can cancel the past. My answer and the answer of the School of Restoration and Conservation here in Politecnico di Milano, but also in Italy, is no. I cannot have this behavior. I cannot select anything. I have to respect and I have to understand everything. Only from the understanding of the existing elements, even if they are ruins and even if, I can conceive a good project for the new additions that are useful, of course, in order to ensure the use of the building. I would like, I said that the conservation approach is sustainable. Yes, it's sustainable because we are avoiding to demolish from one side, and avoiding this, we are also avoiding the problem of the use of sources, human and economic sources, in order to, manage the wastes, for instance. From the other side, and it is important, we have to consider that we can improve labor market. That means that we can improve skills and we can improve also materials, new materials, new tools useful to develop the conservation. So without reducing the normal building labor market, we can improve it. Because in order to make a good restoration and a good project of conservation, perhaps it is necessary to have really new workers and to have new specializations, but also to have new materials, new building materials. So we can improve also the research in this field. The question of the dissemination of conservation is important. And now you can also read in this slide about the preventive and planned conservation. Till several years ago, restoration was something considered as definitely. But nowadays, you know that also the new building must be aged along the time. So I cannot consider that I am building a new building. I am building a new architecture. So when I have the new architecture, immediately after, I have to manage it. So what does it mean? I have to get money, really to get money, in order to manage it, to maintain it along the time. The same for restoration. So I can do the best restoration in the world on my building, But after, I have to conserve it. So I have to maintain it. I cannot forget forget what I made. I cannot forget my build. Remember also that also the new addition, when I had something to the old one, I had to manage it. It is part of this heritage. For this reason, the addition must be a project of architecture, and it must be built with a very strong cultural support, because as architectural is, of course, because after I will have the old elements, the old buildings, the old ruins, but also the addition. And the addition is part of this complex. But after, I have to maintain the old elements, but I have also to maintain the new addition. Pay attention, because this is another question that is important. So we are speaking about preventive and planned conservation, as also Professor De La Torre was with other colleagues, other scholars were defined in order to, how to say, to improve the idea of restoration and conservation. Professor De La Torre is professor here at Politecnico di Milano in restoration, because it is a useful, how to say, behavior that we have to adopt in order to understand the best way to approach the problem of the conservation of cultural heritage, but also the social and economic problem to sustain the conservation process. The conservation process is made by this, a very short summary, by knowledge, by monitoring, by the diagnosis, understanding why the building is damaged, and of course by restoration. Restoration as the action that I am approaching in order to conserve the building. But of course, we have to consider the maintenance, the process of the maintenance of the building after the restoration, and I have also to consider the additions. What we want also to remember is that, and I was speaking about this before, is the social economic dimension of the enhancement of cultural heritage. Now, perhaps I have to clarify. So we have a cultural heritage. We have, if you want, the monument, we have the archaeological place, we have the ancient building, we have the historic centers, and we have to restore, conserve it in order to transfer it to the future generation, but we have also to use it, because remember, so the building must be used. Also Colosseum in Italy is used. It's not only like a pottery in a museum. Colosseum is in the middle, is in the center of Rome. It is a huge and important archaeological remains, but it is also, when I adapt the build, in this case, the archaeological remains, in order to have tourists inside, so I am using these archaeological remains, and I have to use it, because it is a building. So for this reason, I have to consider which is the impact of this use from the social and economic point of view. Of course, about Colosseum, even if Colosseum is a world heritage, but it is a resource, for Rome, for leisure, perhaps for Italy. But which is the impact of the restoration of conservation from the social and economic point of view? This is an important question, and I would like to come back on it. In this moment, what I want to underline instead is the study and the use of the new technologies for the knowledge and for the knowledge of the element and for the to improve a good project of restoration aimed to conservation. You can see here several survey, but not only, also the digitization, the use of the ICT as they are making here in Politecnico di Milano. Thanks, I worked a lot with my colleague Cristiana Achille, and of course the group, the Trevisory Lab, the group of Cristiana, but I would like also to thanks in this moment another colleague, again, expert in the survey of ancient buildings coming from the University of Florence, and she is Grazia Tucci. Again, you can see here several examples of survey made by Politecnico di Milano and Cristiana Achille on different cases of study and archaeological remains in close Rome, a very beautiful Romanic basilica in Pavia, so close Milan, and another small church, close Milan again, very small church, chapel, something like a chapel, in Cesate, a nice place, but very close Milan. But you can see here also this kind of drawing, also connected with the study of the building that was made many years ago, you can see, 1990, when, of course, we had not they were not existing computer at the time, so it was necessary to draw by hand. So, and you can see here that also the wastes were drawn in order to understand the state of conservation of the building. When I speak about the knowledge of the building, when I speak about the knowledge of cultural architectural heritage, because especially I am speaking about architectural heritage, I am speaking about the deep knowledge of it. And also from this kind of drawing, I have to reach this knowledge. If I come back here, also these digital approaches are connected with the deeply knowledge of the building. Of course, now the new instruments, as the 3D laser scan and so on, are offering us a very great opportunity because we can improve our survey and we can understand also something that sometimes is invisible and it is untouchable. But what does restoration means? Restoration is based on the definition of cultural heritage. And what is cultural heritage? So cultural heritage must be defined. What happened in Italy and in Europe in general, but I would like to speak in Italy at the end of the 19th century. In Italy it happened that when the unification of Italy was made, it was necessary for the new government to define the identity, the new identity of Italy. You know that Italy before was divided in several countries. Italy at the time had not a common language, was not existing Italian. So now we speak about Italian is coming from Dante Alighieri. It's true, but they started to study and to define a common language at the time. And for this, and language is part of the identity of a country, of course. For this reason also, they defined our history also considering our monuments. And at the time we started to really to rebuild our monuments, but also to build something that was not existing before in order to give the picture of Italy. So to give the idea of the identity of Italy. Also to the population that was not so able to read and to study, because you know there was not a common language, so it was not that easy for the population, Italian population, to study the past. And according to Yuka Yukileto, that is a very important scholar in ICROM, that is the institution for training and research inside ECOMOS and inside UNESCO. The cultural heritage may be defined as the entire corpus of material science, artistic or symbolic, handed on by the past to each culture and therefore to the whole of humankind as a constituent part of the affirmation and enrichment of cultural identities, as a legacy belonging of the all to all human kinds. The cultural heritage gives each particular place its recognizable features and is the storehouse of a human experience. The preservation and the presentation of cultural heritage are therefore a cornerstone for any cultural policy. Preservation, so I am speaking about conservation. We can consider preservation and conservation more or less with the same meaning, also because in English you can find preservation but also conservation with the same meaning. About presentation, presentation is connected with the dissemination. Presentation, it is very important because presentation is connected also with the training of the population. Now, step by step, we are reaching the local community. I was speaking about the Italian community immediately after the unification of Italy. And we had not at the time an Italian, not local, but Italian community, because we had not a common culture and we had not at the time a common language. Now it is more easy in each country, of course, also in Italy, to speak about local community, and which is the importance of the activity of the local communities on the preservation and conservation of cultural heritage. When you speak about conservation, we are focusing on the material. So conservation means that I have to conserve the material that I can touch now. I am conserving this. The building material is an expression of my good. And this is the witness, the typology of the material, the way to build and to use the material in the construction system. Also the decay of the material is important in order to understand the building. The building, we have to consider the building as an archaeological remains, even if it is not an archaeological remains. So I have to conserve the material. This is a lesson coming from, especially coming from the not only the Italian, but the Italian, I have to say, lesson on restoration and conservation after the Second World War, and it was pushed a lot by two main scholars at the time, even if they were not perfectly in line in the theory of restoration, that there was Cesare Brandi, that is very well known around the world. The theory of restoration by Cesare Brandi was translated in a lot of languages, and from the other side, another scholar, important scholar, was a professor of restoration at the University of Florence, Piero Sampaolesi. So, but now, what is authenticity? In this picture, you can see that this is a postcard. I bought it many years ago in Warsaw. What is restoration and what is the authenticity? Here you can see what happened in Warsaw after the Second World War. So, the city totally destroyed during the Second World War, but by Nazi, was exactly, or better, the historical center of Warsaw was rebuilt. Exactly, it is impossible to say because it is impossible to replace also the materials and the same construction elements. But you can see in the upper part what was Warsaw in 1945 and beyond and below, sorry, what is Warsaw more or less nowadays. But what does it mean to rebuild in this specific situation? According to the Italian lecture, so we can say that for us it's not so significant to rebuild. We prefer to add the new buildings, of course, conserving perhaps the ruins. But which is the meaning of the reconstruction in several situations, as this one? We have to think about this. Another important example is the rebuilding of the Stari Most in Mostar, Bosnia and Herzegovina, after, of course, the war of in the Balkan area. You can see what in the upper part what was the Stari Most before the destruction, and after what was made in order to replace the connection between the two parts of the city, and after the bridge rebuilt. What I would like to ask you, but without so only in order to have an opportunity to think. So, is this better to have exited, rebuilt the element, or perhaps it could be better to maintain a sign of what happened in the past? So we had the bridge, after we have something else. So we have to connect again the two sides, but of the city, but perhaps we can use a different bridge, a different idea of bridge, or as in this case, the rebuilding of the bridge. So it is an important question, according to me, on which it is possible to think. If I can express my idea, according to me, it could be better to maintain, or I would like to see now, not exactly the rebuilt bridge, even if it is not exactly the same of the past, but to see something else, because looking to the picture in the middle, from this picture, I can understand that something happened. And this situation is a witness of what happened, and I cannot really cancel the past. We have other pictures. This is important. This is the Brigittens Church. We are in Brussels. This is a project by Andrea Bruno, and you can see there were two churches, identical twins. One of them collapsed, and Andrea Bruno built another element. You can understand, of course, that it is totally modern. We can discuss about the architectural solution, but it is another question. The question is that now I have the old church, and the other one is totally modern in the respect of the volume, in the respect of more or less of the shape, but we have really a totally different solution. Of course, in this case, we are in Berlin after the Second World War. You see what happened in the church of the Kaiser Wilhelm. And it is a ruin, that is a symbol of what happened. So again, what I can do, I am not obliged to rebuild. I can use the existing building, the existing ruins also with a different meaning. This case is exactly instead what I was saying before. So we are after the unification of Italy, when we replaced the shape of our ancient monuments. This is a very important building. That is the church, the Byzantine church of San Vitale, Ravenna, of the 6th century, as it was before the restoration. Of course, it was modified along the time, but it was modified also because the liturgy for the church changed along the time. But immediately after the unification, we decided to make something like an historical philological restoration in order to replace the same shape. It was impossible, really. And when you enter inside the church, you can find not only the Byzantine period, also because not so much of the Byzantine period remained, but we have also the Baroque period, and we have other historical moments of the church represented in the materials, in the decorations, and so on. This is a situation of the Ponte Vecchio in Florence that was not bombed during the Second World War. All the bridges along the Arno River were destroyed, but not this one. And you can see here, all the other bridges were rebuilt. This was not rebuilt, but it is interesting. You know, the buildings at the end and the starting of the bridge were destroyed. And here you can see the new parts of Florence rebuilt. it is very interesting, because when you are in this part, we are along the street, who is bringing us to from the Piazza della Signoria to Palazzo Pitti, you have not the perception to be in a new city, even if the buildings are totally new, or better, built after the Second World War in the 15-16 of the 20th century. And this is our pictures about what happened around the Ponte Vecchio and on the other bridges along the Arno River. This is Berlin with the reconstruction and the maintaining of the witness of. And now we are entering another kind of examples of what we can find. For instance, this is a project by architect Fidone. This is an early Christian basilica of St. Peter. We are in Sicily. And you can see the, let's say, missed part where rebuilt as a door, as the ceiling, the vault of the main nave of the church, but in a totally new way. So it is a great opportunity for the professional to express himself or herself as an architect, even if they have to respect what it is existing. Here we are in the Cathedral of Reggio Emilia, again in Italy, and you can see again the new addition. And I would like to tell that it is really, again, it is a very good opportunity for an architect to think about new elements added to the old one. This is another example by Professor Andrea Bruno. We are not in Italy, we are in Georgia, we are in Bagrati, Kutaisi, and it is the rebuilding of the Cathedral of Bagrati. And you can see the addition of new elements, new materials to the old one. So only suggestions, because all these cases of study, all these examples need of a lot of discussion, but I would like to give you suggestions about. So the safeguarding of cultural heritage, and specifically architectural heritage as an expression of cultural identity, means the defense, as also the Faro Declaration of 2011, is the defense of the human rights, and it's part of the concept of democracy. Therefore, there is a need for a collective participation in its protection and enhancement, which concerns not only the governing bodies, but also the communities that identify themselves in cultural heritage. So it is necessary to involve the community. Why this? Because the people in general, the people, it is not in a very generic meaning, the people are invited to understand what we have to do about the monuments. They are invited to preserve their history. They are invited to choose also the symbols of their history. At the same time, the government is called in order to support the conservation. And it is called in order to justify all the expenditures useful for this conservation. Government and population, people, and I would like to, of course, to connect, to define these people with the local community, I have to say, this connection, this link is really important, because we have to recognize our heritage. We are invited to conserve them. We are invited to collaborate with the government in order to conserve them. This collaboration is not only because someone can start the restoration of something, it's not this, but which is the, for instance, the impact from the social economic point of view of Colosseum in Rome. Colosseum is triggering also the economy, almost around itself, almost in the center of Rome, because we have a lot of people, we have a lot of tourists. So a lot of Roman citizens are working because Colosseum is existing. But in the same time, the government must, I have to say, ensure the conservation of the building. and have to ensure the expenditure of the building. And it is cool to make understandable these expenditures. The connection between the government and the local community must create opportunities for heritage conservation. Sorry, local community means that I have a more or less small number of people in a well-defined place. Of course, the number of the people and the well-defined place can change case by case. These opportunities are expressed through the understanding of the identity, needs of individual communities, but also in the creation of opportunities for knowledge and work. The conservation and transmission to the future of architectural heritage is grafted on the production process that provides for the formation and creation of a specific labor market, as I said before, with the technologies and specializations that open up new opportunities. Jean Tirole, was a Nobel on economy, about economics for the common good, is writing, the quest for the common good therefore involves constructing the institution to reconcile, as far as possible, the interests of the individual with the general interest. From this perspective, the market economy is not an end in itself. At most, it is an instrument, and an imperfect one, when we consider how to align the common interests and the private interests of individuals, social groups, and nations. Please, I am quoting Jean Tirole. I am not an economist. So I am in this moment using this word, but from my perspective, okay? I am not an economist. I am a degree in architecture, okay? So the question is important, of course, because it is necessary to discuss with economists. You see also a Cultural Heritage Council for Europe, so the sustainable development of population and economy from the cultural, social, environment, and the, of course, economic point of view. That which is the role, for instance, also according to the Faro Convention, of a private body in the conservation of cultural heritage as a common good. It is possible to distinguish two roles, as a backer or sponsors, and as a local community, as a manager of goods, and as a consumer and beneficiary of good. This is really an important question. The local community, as expression of specific social and economic local and regional asset, must be manager of goods if it wants to play a role of a good beneficiary of the goods itself. But as I told before, the local community must work with the government, and the government must work with the local community. You can see here, it is an example, but I pass it very short and very briefly because it is an exercise made by our students. And in this case, I worked with an economist here in Politecnico di Milano. She is my colleague, Camilla Lenti. And we tried to combine economy with the social economic analysis about the assessment, the enhancement of cultural heritage. In this case, this is the results of the analysis made by the students. It is an exam, nothing more, made by the students on a very nice, important place that is the monastery of the seven churches in the Albania region, but we are in Caucasian area, so we are in Azerbaijan. We can see also the project because we are combining the social and economic analysis with the project, which is the methodology approach in this case. We made the SWOT analysis, so I have to say the weakness, the opportunities, the threats of the place. We have, of course, the analysis of the quality of the place. But we made also the analysis of the religion. We are speaking about a Christian area in a Muslim country. We have to understand the culture, the politics, but also the economy, the role of the tourism, which is the valorization proposal, the enhancement proposal, and at the end, the architectural project. And you can see very briefly, also our approach is the conservation of the ruins with the adding of the element. In this case, you can see this is not the exam, but of course, also in this case, Camilla was with us. We are speaking about the workshop Heritage Without Frontiers that we are developing here at Politecnico di Milano. Now you can see another way to study the building. It is a very totally different building. We are very close to Milan, in Legnano. This is a modern building built in 1938, more or less. It was totally abandoned. And now, with also again my colleague Cristiana Achille, we are studied it, and it is also we have studied it also inside an European project. And now I go very fast. I am going very fast. I would like to show you what we are doing in Politecnico di Milano, but not only, which is the approach that we have, the study of the buildings, the study of the materials, also from the historical point of view, from the survey point of view, the materials. And now I can pass very fast the laboratories that we have in Politecnico di Milano in order to study the building, the ancient buildings, and in order to improve, of course, our cultural heritage. This is the laboratories, this is all the activities, analysis of materials, chemical analysis, physical analysis, in order to make the diagnosis of the state of conservation. Of course, the survey of the building, I spoke a lot about this, but also the study, for instance, of the new buildings, the modern architecture with modern, not only ancient material, but also the modern one as the reinforced concrete cement. But in this case, one of the best paintings that we have, that is the Last Supper by Leonardo da Vinci. And thank you very much. I hope my lecture was clear enough. Thank you really for your attention.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Professor Lombardini. Very insightful. We can open now the question and answer part. And maybe while the attendees are typing their questions, I can start to ask mine. you mentioned at the beginning of this of the lecture you talk about the Colosseum, the Colosseum in Rome, and the use of the fact that the building has to have a use, and there are talks about the transforming the Colosseum into a stadium for events and sports. Would you consider this an acceptable use of the building? So for those who are not familiar with this discussion, there's this big project of making the Colosseum. You know, the Colosseum, it was an event, a space in ancient Rome, where there were the games, the gladiator games, etc. And now they are talking about transforming it into an event place where their sports can be conducted, fashion show can be conducted as well. So to really make this a money-making,
It is clear. No, thank you so much for this question, because really, yes. For me, yes, I agree with this possibility, because what it is important, I speak for me, but for the School of Conservation that now I am trying to represent, is the respect of the historical part of this building. So I have to study, and what I am adding cannot be dangerous for the existing part, for the ancient part. But of course, we have to use our monuments. If you remember, Arena di Verona is more or less the same. Arena di Verona is a Roman theater, as a Colosseum, but now we are using a lot for several events, important events, because it is very difficult to maintain a building, because we are speaking about building construction. It's not a painting. on a wall, but it is a construction only as something that I have to see and nothing more. It is necessary to use also our past, but in the respect of the historical materials, historical structures.
Okay, and then I have a follow-up question. Like in the case of the restoration of the buildings in the center, in the historical center, the cases where it's kept only the facade and not the building itself behind. I mean, the inside of the building is completely, how do you say?
Rebuilt again.
Rebuilt, yes. And yes, the space is readapted, etc. How would you consider this?
So, no, I don't agree with this practice. Even if we applied it more or less 30, 40 years ago also in Italy, we had a special law about this. So also in the center of Milan, you can see a lot of ancient facades and behind there is something else. The question of the historic centers and the dwellings, I mean the houses, the normal houses, is of course an important question. Because sometimes we are obliged, or we were obliged to improve them also from the structural point of view, because you know in Italy we have earthquakes, so in order to ensure the use of this building also according to the laws. What I would like to try to say before is instead that we have to know very well the building and we have to improve the existing structures. So we have the possibility, we have also new materials, we have new skills, we have new trainings that can help us not to change what is existing, but to improve it. And it is possible to do nowadays. So we have to reduce a lot the approach that means to change, to destroy what is existing, to demolish what is existing in order to build something else. No, I don't agree.
Thank you. we have a question from Professor Cruz, Noel Cruz, a friend. We say hello to him. He says, thank you very much for the very informative presentation, Prof. Lombardini. I'm curious to know your opinion regarding the effects of modern skyscrapers in city skylines, which serve as a backdrop of heritage structure. Example, is the presence of modern structure in a historical area of Repubblica Porta Garibaldi in Milan, due to the Expo 2015. We have similar concern here in the Philippines, where high-rise condominiums development are built around the historical building and monuments.
Yes, really. According to me, it is impossible to stop the development of a city. So the question is why we are building this kind of buildings, for instance, in the skyscrapers, and in which kind of project from the urban point of view and the architectural point of view I have behind. Again, it is necessary to know very well where I am going to build these new elements. I am not against, but the question is why. I have not the picture now, but in Warsaw, for me, what it is very interesting for me, of course, the center of Warsaw is very nice. It was totally rebuilt. Also the castle is totally new, even if with an ancient shape. But what it is interesting for me is the tower, the gift by the Russian period, the Soviet period, that for me is very interesting for a lot of reasons, from the historical point of view, but also from the architectural one. It was like one of the seven sisters that we have in Moscow, but it was interesting for me, but not for the population in Warsaw, because this building is a symbol of something that they wanted to remove from their history. What they are making now is not to demolish this tower, that is very useful also because there are a lot of offices inside, but they built other skyscrapers around in order to create a confusion and to hide this element behind something else. I think this approach is very interesting. I would like to understand a bit better. I don't know if I agree with this approach. I don't know if it is clear what I am saying. So I have, so I cannot stop the improvement of the city. I cannot stop the history. I cannot stop also several needs. The question is that I have to understand very well where and why I am doing this in the respect also of the past. Past is not a limit. Past must be transformed in an opportunity. The respect of the past, I mean.
Along this line, Jason Ramirez is asking, what is your take about the restoration of the Notre Dame in Paris, where the roof got burned and the architects were clearly divided to their approach? Some architects wanted to create innovative ideas to the roof, but others wanted to remake it as it was with the original techniques. Mm.
So the techniques were original, but not so original because they are, we are coming from the 19th century, eh? Because it was a restoration by Viollet-le-Duc. What I think, in case we wanted to transform really, of course it is my opinion, huh? Only my opinion. In order to transform this roof, it is necessary to have a very good project again. But especially in this case, I would like to tell why I have to transform. An example, the Cathedral of Milan. The Cathedral of Milan is not finished yet. It was started in more or less in the late medieval period, and now it's not finished yet. Hmm? So where is the authenticity of the Cathedral of Milan? Of course, in the materials, also in the ancient one and so on and so on, but also in the way to manage it. We have also, it is an intangible heritage. Hmm? And in the case of Notre Dame, again, in this moment, I can confirm that I would like to see the rebuilt element in this moment, because the suggestions, the other project suggested, according to me, was a bit out of order. But the question is, what is the meaning also of the Cathedral of Notre Dame? Hmm? Which kind of symbols is it? And which is really the meaning in not only in Paris, but also in the other country? The question in this moment is to conserve again what it is existing and to maintain exactly the memory of what are they doing now. Because what it is important for us is to know very well what they are doing, because it is a document, again, an historical document for the future generation.
I was muted. Okay, thank you. There's another question from Angelo De La Cruz. He says, will the conservation of a heritage building's current state be much more preferable than to restoring it? If its current state has adapted to the changes of time, and that the restoration to its original form will make it detached to its current built environment, isn't the culture of the present just as important as the culture of the past?
No, the culture, of course, so first of all, what it is important, what I am trying to say is that we have to improve, pay attention, our culture. Mm? The culture of today is, we have to create a good culture in any country. Perhaps the culture is also different from Philippine to Italy and so on. But we have to maintain our culture. We have to to remember our culture, but we have to improve it. Hmm? And also the new architecture is expression of a new culture. Hmm? So we cannot stop the new buildings. The question is that we have to build very good buildings. we have to, we must be able to do a very good architecture, again, in the respect of the past, understanding the past. Again, past and existing elements that are also the witness of our past, they are not a limit for our project. Can be an opportunity with whom we can compare new architecture and also from which we can learn, but we have to improve new architecture, new ideas, of course.
I'm going to change topic, and there are two questions from Marvin Tejada. It says, how do we ensure that conservation of our cultural heritage be financed sustainably? And the other one is more or less along the same topic. So how does the conservation be prioritized against the burgeoning urbanization of our cities?
Yes, this is another about the sustainability. Again, when I am able, and I have trained my students to be able to do this, when I am able to improve an existing building, the ancient one or old, simply old one, I am able to do a sustainable project, but especially I can justify the expenditure. So, I don't know, perhaps sometimes it is necessary also to remove something, but pay attention. What does it mean to remove something? Which is I have to balance the cost of the removing and the cost of the conservation and the reuse and the improvement of the existing. When I have more costs, when this work is an exceptional work, because if usually I do this, I have skills, I have materials, I have everything, so it is not so much expensive. If it is this approach is una tantum, of course it is very, very expensive. So that is the question. Sorry, because I don't remember the other question, so sorry.
The other question was about the development of the city and how can we prioritize?
Yes. No, yes, of course. Also in this case, we can improve the city also in the respect of the existing one. It is not impossible. And again, I know we have to study. Before touching something, we have to understand and to study. Because it is not, as an archaeologist, if you want. But now, for instance, with my student coming from Georgia, from Tbilisi, we discussed about the question of urban conservation and urban health in Tbilisi, for instance. In order to improve the city, also from the point of view of the well-being, but considering also cultural heritage as an element, an important element of the well-being of the population. Now, we were speaking about Tbilisi because Marian was coming from Belize, but it is true for Rome, for Milano, or for all the other cities.
There are other questions that I will summarize. How externals from the society and new generation all because you were mentioning at the beginning that it's really the society, the inhabitants of the city that needs to signal or signify to the authorities what are the monuments, the heritage that they want to preserve. No, yeah. So in these regards, what the new generations, how they interact with the heritage, or newcomers that arrive in the cities, are they able to be part of this process? Or how is the even from the didactic point of view? I mean,
yes,
from
yes,
the
yes, yes, of course. I have to say, that, for instance, in Italy, and I am speaking about our experience in Italy, usually when, so first of all, I would like to underline that in Italy, in our universities, we are teaching restoration because immediately after the master degree, the architects can touch monument, okay? So there are not special courses. So for this reason, we are obliged, of course, to introduce the students in the higher education in the university in order to understand architecture, monuments, historical, cultural heritage, architectural heritage. The main question is that the young people must be trained in this. I was the last week in Germany in an UNESCO meeting about education, also according to the new strategies approved by UNESCO on education. Now it is urgent to educate the people also from the primary and secondary school, also about cultural heritage. What does it mean, pay attention, that this new very new generation will be professionals, but also administratives, and so on and so on. So they will be able to acquire a common language, a common way to understand the past, and they will be able, as we hope, to improve in a very common way the conservation, the preservation of heritage. The involvement of population is important. The restoration, we have to avoid, if it is possible, to transform in an ideological action what is the destruction or the restoration of a monument. The restoration, or if you want the destruction, even if, of course, I am not pushing in this direction, not at all, it can be, and we hope to be able to do this, can be only a cultural action, not an ideological one. So it is necessary, perhaps we can remember what happened to the mausoleum of Dimitrov, the dean of the communism in Sofia, in Bulgaria, that was destroyed by the new government, not by the population. That is an important.
Exactly. Along this line, I connect really with your last sentence. And there's a Max Maxino who mentioned here in the Philippines, the support of the government is not that evident. What can you suggest in order to strengthen the preservation, conservation of this cultural heritage from the government side? I mean, how can we involve the authorities in this problem?
It's not good. To catch government is not easy everywhere. So I have to understand which kind of level of the government I have to catch. So what now we are doing inside the university is to involve several, level of the administration, the public administration, in order to, so we are calling them, we are trying to discuss with them inside the university, and we try to exchange together ideas in order to find the points of connection between the needs of cultures and the needs of administration. Because of course the administration of the country is not easy everywhere. The question is what we want to do. It is necessary also to clarify what we want to reach with our actions. Of course, the government are not the same everywhere. So again, the question is really to find a connection, to try again to find the connection. Only through the dialogue between the two parts, I think it is possible to reach a cultural approach to the protection, first of all, and the restoration conservation of heritage.
Just last question about the movement of the moving a monument or a cultural heritage from one place to another one for different reason, no? How would you, because that's completely a different set yes. compared to what we have discussed so far, maintaining the environment, etc. Here is preservation, but decontextualized.
Yes, if in this moment, from the Italian point of view, this approach, I would like to tell you, is really forbidden. Mm? Also, we are trying to conserve everything, if you want, also the sculptured elements in the facade of a church, for instance, and so on. We are trying to conserve exactly any element in its, each element in its environment. That is one of our priority, the priority of our approach. Why this? Because when I was speaking about, we have to know very well the situation about the geographical, the social, the material, the economy that we can, on which the, I have to say, the heritage is staying. Because when I have to transform a place, first of all, I have to understand the place. Perhaps now I want to transform that place, but there is a very important heritage and I cannot touch it. So I can try to move my, I have to say, to move my intention and to use another place. Perhaps it is better than the other one. So I have to understand and I have to respect, but starting from the knowledge, starting from the knowledge. I don't know if it's clear what I am saying.
I think it is. I mean, I think we can close here. The other question were more or less all answered. If there are to the audience, if there are other questions that you'd like to ask, and feel free to send us an email, and then perhaps we can forward it to Professor Lombardini for.
Of course, I am at your disposal.
So thank you very much. Yeah, and this is not the last Politech story. There will be more. So. We will send you an email when the next appointment will next encounter will be fixed. So again, thank you very much, Professor. Thank you very much to the Politecnico, and thank you to all who attended. We are 155 now connected. So I think is we are a lot.
Grazie, professoressa.
Also on behalf of me, but also on behalf of Politecnico di Milano. To our friends in Philippines. Thank you so much.